Hello, welcome to the network functions and the port zero plot presentation. This is a two-port network which has an input port. The input port is connected to the supply voltage of VG volts having an internal impedance of ZG ohms. The input port voltage is termed as V1 and input port current is shown as I1. The output port is connected to the load impedance and is having the current I2, the direction of which is shown in the diagram. The output port voltage is V2. Now in the network functions, we have different types of network functions. First, we have the driving point function, in which we have a driving point impedance function, which is defined as the ratio of voltage transform at one port to the current transform at the same port. Similarly, the driving point admittance function, the ratio of current transform at one port to the voltage transform at the same port. Now, these two definitions, they are for the single port network. For the two port network, we can define the driving point input impedance function and driving point admittance impedance function in this way. For example, if I want to define the driving point admittance function, input admittance function Y11 of S, it will be given as the ratio of the current transform at the input port to the ratio of, the ratio of current transform at the input port to the voltage transform at the input port. Similarly, at the output port, that is port number 2, I can define the driving point output impedance function and the driving point output admittance function. For example, if I want to define Z22 of S, it will be defined as the voltage transform at the output port. It's the ratio of the voltage transform at the output port to the current transform at the output port. Similarly, in case of transfer functions, you have what is called as a voltage transfer function, which is given as, say, for example, G21 of S is given as V1 of S divided by V2 of S. That is, you can define it as the ratio of voltage transform at the input port to the voltage transform at the output port. Transfer function. Again, we have what is called as a current transfer function. For example, if I want to define alpha 12 of S, it will be given as I2 of S divided by I1 of S. That is, I can define it as the ratio of the current transform at the output port to the current transform at the input port. In the transfer impedance function, you have Z12 of S and Z21 of S. If I want to define Z21 of S, I can define it as it is a ratio of the voltage transform at the input port to the current transform at the output port. And lastly, we have the transfer admittance function. For example, I can define here Y21 of S, which is I1 of S divided by V2 of S. And you can define it as the ratio of current transform at the input port to the voltage transform at the output port. As far as the poles and the zeros of the network functions are concerned, this is F of S. The numerator polynomial is given as N of S, and the denominator polynomial is given as D of S. The numerator polynomial a0 to an, they are the coefficients of the polynomial N of S, and b1 to bm, they are the coefficients of the polynomial D of S. When you factorize the numerator and the denominator polynomial, or you find out the roots of the numerator and denominator polynomial, you can write the same function of f of s is equal to h into s minus z1 till s minus zn divided by s minus p1 to s minus pm, where h is a constant, it's called as a scale factor. And what is the Z1, Z2 till ZPM, Zn, and what is P1, P2 till PM? So Z1 to Zn, they are called as the zeros, and P1 to PM, they are called as the poles. Now poles and zeros, they are called as the critical frequencies. At poles, you'll find that the network function becomes infinite. For example, if I put down here S equal to P1 or P2 or S equal to PM, this network function F of S will become infinite. Similarly, the zeros are the critical frequencies at which the network function becomes zero. So if I put S equal to Z1, S equal to Z2, or S equal to Zn, we'll find that F of S will vanish out or it will become equal to zero. The poles and zeros can be indicated on the pole zero plot, where the poles are generally indicated in terms of cross, you know, they're indicated as a cross on the pole zero plot, and the zeros are indicated by the circles. Here I have a function f of s, which is equal to s into s plus 2 divided by square plus s plus 2. The denominator term can be factorized as shown here. So if I take the whole zero plot of this particular function, you can see that one zero exists at s equal to 0. So I put a circle at the origin. Another zero is located at s equal to minus 2. So here you can see there's a circle at s equal to minus 2. The pole exists at s equal to minus 1 minus j. So you can see s equal to minus 1 minus j. So there is a cross here. Another pole is existing at s equal to minus 1 plus j. That is minus 1 plus j. So in the pole zero plot, you'll find that you have the real axis, which is called as it's denoted as sigma, the real axis, and you have the imaginary axis, vertical imaginary axis, or the j omega axis. You can take a suitable scale for this. And here the scale factor you can see is 1. So you can write down here that h scale factor is equal to 1. Similarly for this function, there is a 0 at the origin, s equal to 0. So I mark a circle here at the origin. There is another 0 at s equal to minus 2. So I locate a circle at s equal to minus 2. Similarly, there is a pole at s equal to minus 1 here. So cross at minus 1. And s equal to minus 3, there is another pole. So a cross at minus 3. So this is a pole zero plot, you can say, for this particular function. Now from the pole zero plot, you can get what is the time domain behavior. For example, if I have a pole at the origin, then the response of this particular function in the time domain will be something like this. Similarly, if you have a pole on the left half of the s-plane, you'll find that the time domain response of this function will be as shown here. So in both the cases, I say that the function is stable or realizable, because for a bounded input, I'm getting a bounded output or a bounded response. But if you see here, if the pole is lying on the right half of the s-plane, then its response in the time domain, it will go on increasing indefinitely, exponential increase. So here I say that the given function is unstable or unrealizable, and for a bounded input, it is not giving me a bounded output. It is giving me an unbounded output or an unbounded response. Here, if I have the complex conjugate poles on the imaginary axis, I have sustained sinusoidal oscillations. In this case also, I say that the system is stable, or the function is stable and realizable. This case, you have the complex conjugate poles on the left half of the s-plane. In that case, the time domain response will be underdamped oscillations. These oscillations will go on dampening over a period of time. So this also I can say is the function is stable and realizable, because for a bounded input, it is giving me a bounded output or a bounded response. But here you can see there is a pole on the right half of the s-plane. So in that case, we'll find that the oscillations will be there, and these oscillations will subsequently go on increasing over a period of time. So here I am getting a unbounded output or unbounded response for a bounded input. So this particular function I can say is unstable or unrealizable. Now in both these cases here, the poles are lying on the left half of the s-plane, but if the pole is lying near to the imaginary axis, the response is something like this. But if this pole is lying, its distance is far away from the imaginary axis, then the response that you get is in this way. Similarly, if you have a complex conjugate pole, poles which are lying near to the imaginary axis, the response is this. But if the complex conjugate poles are lying far away from the imaginary axis, then the response is something like this. So the response also depends upon how far these poles are near, how far these poles are from the imaginary axis. So that is very important. We have taken an example where the network is given. We have to find out the network function I0 upon I1, and from that we have to get the pole zero plot. So here you can see all these impedances, they are transformed to the S domain, and I0 is the current through the impedance of 2 by S. I1 is the total current, so I apply the current division formula where I0 is equal to, current through this branch is equal to, total current I1 multiplied by the opposite impedance, that is 4 plus 2s in the numerator, divided by the sum of all these three impedances, that is 4 plus 2s plus 2 by s. So when I do this, I get the, take the ratio I0 upon I1 is working out to be, and factorize it also, I get it as s into s plus 2 divided by s plus 1 plus into bracket s plus 1. So now, if this is the function I0 upon I1, I get a pole zero plot. You can see that there is a 0 at the origin, s equal to 0. So I mark a circle here at the origin. There is another 0 at s equal to minus 2. So I locate a circle at s equal to minus 2 here in the left half of the s-plane. Similarly, there are two poles you can see at the same location, s equal to minus 1, s equal to minus 1. So I show two crosses here at s equal to minus 1. Now this indicates that there are multiple poles lying at a location of s equal to minus 1. So this is a simple example where a network is given. We find out the network function I0 upon I1 and in the S domain, and from this particular equation, once I get it, and I factorize the numerator as well as the denominator polynomial, then I show the locations of the poles and the zeros on the pole zero plot. The scale factor h is equal to 1 here, so you can write down the scale factor as h equal to 1. In this case, this is a single port network function, and we have to find out what is asked here is driving point admittance function has to be found out. So what we do is we first find out the driving point impedance function. Now Z of S is nothing but the equivalent impedance as viewed from the open circuited terminals here. So if we try to find out the equivalent impedance, these two impedances are in parallel and the equivalent of that is in series with this and this impedance. So I can say that these two impedances are in parallel, so its equivalent will be S into 1 upon 2S divided by S plus 1 upon 2S. And the equivalent of these two impedances in parallel is in series with this impedance, that is plus 1 upon 5S and this impedance. So I add it here, plus 3S. So the equivalent impedance as viewed from these terminals here, Z of S working out to be 30S raised to 4 plus 22S square plus 1 divided by 5S into 2S square plus 1. I want the driving point admittance function, so I take the reciprocal of this, 1 upon Z of S. So when I take that, Y of S, the driving point admittance function, works out to be 5S into bracket 2S square plus 1 divided by 30S raised to 4 plus 22S square plus 1. This is a ladder type network where we have to find out all these transfer functions, V2 upon V1, I2 upon I1, V2 upon I1M, V1 upon I1. So here you can see this is the output port voltage V2. Node voltage here is VB and VC. But from the diagram, we can see that VB is equal to VC is equal to V2. So that is what we have written here. Now the branch current I2 is given here. Current through this branch, I will call it as IB. Current through this branch, I will call it as IA. And current through this branch is already given, I1. Now to find out I2 here, I2. That will be the current passing through this 1 ohm resistance. It will be given as VC upon 1, but VC is equal to V2. So I say I2 is equal to V2 upon 1, that is equal to V2. Now IA, that is this current IA, is the sum of the current IB and I2. So I write down here, IA is equal to IB plus I2. But what is IB? Current through this branch is the potential here, VB, which is nothing but V2 divided by the impedance of 2 plus 2 by S. So I take here, IA is equal to V2 upon 2 plus 2 by S and plus the current to this branch I2 is V2, so plus V2. So when I simplify this, I get IA is equal to 3S plus 2 divided by 2S plus 2 into V2. Similarly, VA, this node potential here, VA, is the voltage drop across this impedance 3S plus VB. So I can write down here, VA is equal to voltage drop across impedance 3S is 3S into IA plus V2. So that is equal to 3S into IA is this, so I put down the value of IA here and plus V2. So here I get the equation of VA in terms of V2. Similarly, if I want to find out the current I1, this current I1 is the current through this branch plus IA. So I1, the current through this branch will be node voltage VA divided by this impedance 1 upon S. So VA upon 1 upon S plus this current IA. So I1 then becomes equal to SVA plus IA, or is equal to SVA is this. You can write down the VA here in terms of V2 plus IA in terms of V2 is this. So I put down the value of IA here in terms of V2. So finally, I get the equation of I1 in terms of V2. And I want the ratio of V2 upon I1 here. So I can take C, I get the first ratio, network function, V2 upon I1, which is nothing but 2S plus 2 divided by 9S cubed plus 8S squared plus 5S plus 2. Now, V1, if we can see here, this voltage V1 will be the drop across this impedance plus VA. Now, 3 and 3 by S, these impedances are in parallel. So if you find the equivalent of that, it will be 3 into 3 by S divided by 3 plus 3 by S. So that is working out to be this, 3 upon S plus 1. So this node voltage V1 will be the voltage drop across this, that is 3 upon S plus 1 into I1 plus this node voltage VA. So V1 then is equal to 3 upon S plus 1. I1, I will put it in this equation, I1 in terms of V2 here, and plus VA. VA in terms of V2 is this, 9S square plus 8S plus 2 divided by 2S plus 2. So I put down the equation of VA, this equation of VA in terms of V2 here. So finally, you can see here, I'm getting V1 in terms of V2. So I get V1 is equal to this term here into V2. So I get the ratio here, V2 upon V1, which is the next network function I want here. V2 upon V1 will be equal to 2S square plus 4S plus 2 divided by 36X cubed plus 41S square plus 25S plus 8. Now, once I have this V2 upon V1 and V2 upon I1, I can get this V1 upon I1 very easily if I take this ratio, that is V2 upon V1 divided by v2 upon i1. So this v2 v2 term will get cancelled out, and you can get the third network function, that is v1 upon i1, which is working out to be this way: 36x cubed plus 41x squared plus 25x plus 8 divided by 9x raised to 4 plus 17x squared plus 17x cubed plus 13x squared plus 7x plus 2. To get the ratio network function i2 upon i1, you can see here i2 is equal to v2. But what is v2? You can see here i1 is equal to this term into v2. So I can replace v2 here in terms of i1. v2 will be equal to 2s plus 2 divided by 9s cubed plus 8s squared plus 5s plus 2 into i1. So that value of v2 in terms of i1 I will put down here. So you can see v2 is eliminated, and get the equation of i2 in terms of i1, so that you can simplify it and get the last network function, that is i2 upon i1, which works out to be 2s plus 2 divided by 9s cubed plus 8s squared plus 5s plus 2. This is another network which is transformed into the S domain here. So we have shown the three loops here. This is loop 1, loop current I1, loop 2, loop current I2, and loop 3 is a loop current I3. I apply KVL to the first loop, I get this equation. When I apply KVL to the second loop, I get this equation. When I apply KVL to the third loop, I'm getting this equation. When I apply the KVL to the third loop, I can get the equation of I3 in terms of I1. So I3 is working out to be S upon 2S plus 1 into I1. Now, from this equation, I want to eliminate I3, and from the second equation also, I want to eliminate I3. So I put down the equation of I3 in terms of I1 here in equation 1 and equation 2. So when I do that, I get V1 is equal to, this first term remains as it is, 1 plus 1 upon S into I1 minus I3 is replaced by S upon 2S plus 1 into I1. So when you simplify this, you will get V1 in terms of I1, this equation. Similarly, in the second equation, V2 is equal to, first term remains as it is, 1 upon S I1 plus I3 again here is S upon 2S plus 1 into I1. So when you simplify this, here you will get V1 in terms of I1, here you will get V2 in terms of I1. So finally, what we want here is the network function V1 upon I1, which you can get from here. V1 upon I1 is S square plus 3S plus 1 divided by S into bracket 2S plus 1. Similarly, the next network function, that is V2 upon I1, which is here, you can get it as S square plus 2S plus 1 upon S into bracket 2S plus 1. And if you want to get V2 upon V1, you will take the ratio now, this V2 upon I1 divided by V1 upon I1. So when you do that, I1 I1 will get cancelled out, and you will get the last network function, that is V2 upon V1, which is working out to be S square plus 2S plus 1 divided by S square plus 3S plus 1. So that is a numerical second one, where we are finding out all this Z1 1 of S, that is driving point input impedance function, Z1 2 of S, that is a transfer impedance function, and we are finding out the voltage ratio, a voltage transfer function, that is G1 2 of S. One more network here. Again, you can see the I1 is given, I2 equal to 0 is given, IB is the current through this branch, and this is also the current through this branch is given here, I1. So now here, this node voltage VB, because I2 is equal to 0, you'll find that whatever is the current IB passing through this branch, the same current is passing through this branch. So that is why in both this branch, you know, the current mentioned is IB only. This is node voltage VA here, node voltage VB here. From the diagram, we can see that this node voltage VB is equal to V2. But what is IB? IB is VB, that is V2 divided by this impedance, that is 1 upon S. So I say IB is equal to SV. Similarly, if I want to get another equation, I can say that VA is equal to drop across this impedance plus VB. And drop across this impedance is IB into S. So I can say that VA is equal to IB into S plus VB. IB into S plus VB. But VB is nothing but V2. So that is equal to V2 plus S into IB is SV2 here. So put down the value of IB as SV2. You finally get the equation of VA is equal to V2 into bracket S square plus 1. Now what is I1? I1 you can see is the current which is equal to the current in this branch plus IB. So I1 I can say is the current of this branch is VA divided by 1 upon 2S. That is VA divided by 1 upon 2S plus IB. So when I write down this, I1 then becomes equal to 2S VA plus IB. Or I1 is equal to 2S. What is VA? VA is V2 into S square plus 1. So I put down the value of VA here. Plus IB is SV2. IB is SV2. So I get the equation finally of I1 in terms of V2 when you simplify it. Similarly, V1 I can say here is equal to the voltage drop across this impedance plus VA. So V1, voltage across this impedance is I1 into 2S plus VA. So this. That is equal to 2S. What is I1 in terms of V2? It is V2 into 2s cube plus 3s plus what is VA in terms of V2? It is V2 into S square plus 1. So you see, then putting down the values of VA and I1 in this equation. So finally, when you simplify this, you will get the equation of V1 in terms of V2. Here I want the ratio of V2 upon V1 here, which I am getting it from here. V2 upon V1 is equal to 1 upon 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1. Now, from here I get V2 is equal to V1 upon 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1 from this equation. And I1, you can see here, I1 is equal to, what is V2? I'll put down the value of V2 as this, V1 divided by 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1. So I can say that I1 is equal to this V1 divided by 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1 multiplied by this 2s cube plus 3s. So I'm getting the equation of I1 in terms of V1 from here. Just by putting this V2's equation, V2 in terms of V1, I'm putting it here. So I get the equation I1 in terms of V1. Now I want the transfer function V2 upon I1. What is V2? V2 is V1 upon 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1. That is this, divided by what is I1? I1 is V1 into bracket 2s cube plus 3s divided by 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1. So when I put this V2 upon I1 here, V1, V1 gets cancelled out. Even this term, 4s raised to 4 plus 7s square plus 1 gets cancelled out in the numerator and denominator. So finally, you'll find that Z21 of S, which is nothing but V2 upon I1, works out to be 1 upon 2s cube plus 3s. And this is regarding the necessary conditions for the driving point function and the transfer function, or the restrictions on the poles and the zeros locations for the driving point function and the transfer function. So as far as the driving point function is concerned, the coefficients in the polynomials N of S and D of S must be real and positive. The poles and the zeros, if complex or imaginary, must occur in conjugate pairs. The real part of all poles and zeros must be negative or zero. That is, the poles and zeros must lie in the left half of the S-plane. If the real part of the pole or zero is zero, then that pole or zero must be simple. The polynomials N of S and D of S may not have missing terms between those of highest and lowest degree, unless all even or odd terms are missing. The degree of N of S and D of S may differ by either zero or one only. This condition prevents multiple poles and zeros at S equal to infinity. The last condition here, the terms of lowest degree in N of S and D of S may differ in degree by one at most. This condition prevents multiple poles and zeros at S equal to zero. Similarly here, for the transfer function, the coefficients in the polynomials N of S and D of S must be real, and those of D of S must be positive. Poles and zeros, if complex or imaginary, must be conjugate. The real parts of poles must be negative or zero. If the real part is zero, then the pole must be simple. The polynomials D of S may not have any missing terms between that of the highest and lowest degree, unless all the even or odd terms are missing. The polynomials N of S may have terms missing between the terms of lowest and highest degree, and some of the coefficients may be negative. The degree of N of S may be as small as zero, independent of the degree of D of S. For voltage and current transfer functions, the maximum degree of N of S is the degree of D of S. And the last condition, transfer function, for transfer impedance and admittance functions, the maximum degree of N of S is the degree of D of S plus 1. Now, these conditions are necessary as far as the driving point and the transfer function are concerned, because only if the conditions are met, you'll find that these driving point functions or the transfer functions will be stable functions, or they'll be the realizable functions. So that is why these conditions are very, very important.